Welcome to Myrtle Beach Advice Givers Podcast, sharing stories and insights from business owners and thought leaders in your Myrtle Beach community. Now, here are your hosts, authors, entrepreneurs, and real estate innovators, Sean Brooks and Doug Van Buskirk.
Welcome back to the Myrtle Beach Advice Givers Podcast, where we interview business owners, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders to give the best advice to the community. I'm your host, Sean Brooks, along with my PIC, Mr. Doug Van Buskirk. Doug, what's going on, my brother?
Oh, man, I am really, really, really looking forward to Tim today. You know I have got a problem dog on my hands, and I'm hoping he can get to the bottom of the issue for us. And I know a lot of our listeners are probably feeling the same way.
Yeah, absolutely. I've had this interview circled on my calendar with a couple stars around it for a little while now. Because our guest is, you know, might be one of the most highly skilled, in their niche or in their perspective field, than we've had on the show so far. So I think it's going to be incredible. And, he works with dogs. He's a, world-class dog handler. And so, our affinity to dogs, most of our listeners' affinity with dogs, and quite frankly, most of the people anywhere, who doesn't love a dog? Who doesn't love a puppy, right?
It's a universal thing. It's like a universally human thing, I feel like.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, they're our four-legged child. Both of us could probably use some pointers as well. So, he's going to talk to us today about, how he rose to the top and literally became, one of the best, dog handlers by far that I've ever met, but really in the world. I mean, when we start getting into his background and what he's been able to accomplish, I mean, he was at the top 1% of the top 1%, which is pretty crazy and pretty awesome. What's really cool is that he's actually now in Myrtle Beach, right around the corner, and he's the handler for K9Cabana here in Myrtle Beach, which is the dog training resort and spa. So, really excited, like if
a former NBA player was running a basketball camp here in Myrtle Beach or something. I mean, it truly is.
Exactly. That's a great analogy. I mean, it really truly is. And, the fact that he's right here in our own backyard, is pretty incredible. And so we're definitely lucky to have him on the show here today. And, I want to, thank everyone again for tuning in. Like I said, we're always excited to bring this show to life and continue to look forward to connecting local business owners, local experts in their field to our community. So, if you haven't already done so, get onto iTunes, go ahead, click the subscribe button, leave us a review, let us know what you think. If you like what you hear, please share this with a friend. And if you have any questions as usual, or if you're interested in the show or know someone who might be, you can get some more information online at MyrtleBeachAdviceGivers.com, or you can reach out to me personally, which is Sean, S-E-A-N, at MyrtleBeachAdviceGivers.com. Okay, Doug. You ready to rock?
Let's do this.
Without further ado, let's get it on. Alrighty, well, I'm super excited to have us on the show today. World-class dog trainer here in Myrtle Beach at K9Cabana, Tim Culver. Tim, how you doing today, man? And thanks for being on the show.
Good, brother. Thank you very much. Excited to be here.
Awesome, man. Yeah, we're definitely excited, particularly excited to have you on the show today. Personally, with our affinity two dogs, and I know how many people that we're connected with and who listen to the show who also love their four-legged friends just as much. So, we've been looking forward to this for a little while here. Should be a lot of fun. Your credentials are pretty, pretty impressive and interesting. So yeah, man, we're stoked. So, I think that, before we get into really some details, and I've got some really fun questions lined up later on the show. Kind of want to learn a little bit about you. Kind of take us back over the next couple minutes here. Give us the story of who you are, how you came to be, where you come from, where you went to school, how you got to Myrtle Beach, and all that fun stuff.
I enlisted in the Marines straight out of high school, 2006. Was super impacted over what happened. 9/11. And, wanted to, the best I could, make an impact, I come from a military family. My sister was already in the Army. My older brother was already in the Marines. It just definitely seemed like something. I mean, I knew I wanted to do. Went to the recruiter, was flipping through the book of the different jobs, and I saw somebody, you know, with a military working dog working them in Iraq, and it just instantly hit me. I kind of paused it there with the recruiter and had to go back home and look more into it, research it a little bit more. I came back, said that's what I wanted to do, enlisted as a military policeman, and went to the school from there. Found out that, you know, you have to be selected to be a military working dog handler. So I fought hard for that, and got selected to go to military working dog school at Lackland Air Force Base, which is kind of a basic handler's course, they call it. You learn the basics of patrol work, how to train a dog to bite, how to work as a decoy or the person getting bit, and explosive detection, narcotics. And you laugh, but that is the most important part. And that's actually the person with the suit on, the person with the sleeves on, that's the guy that's actually training the dog.
Really?
The person holding the dog is what I tell my personal protection clients. You know, for now, you're just sort of a back tie. Like, just hold on to him. And yeah, the person wearing the suit is actually the one training the dog, building their confidence, you know, getting really small when they need to, getting big, building the dog's confidence, which is crucial with that.
That's incredible. Yeah, I want to stop you there for a second. So, you know, you basically went in to the military with this idea. I mean, you had no other precursor of, you know, training dogs at this point. It was just something that, you know, you were sitting there in the recruiter's office and said, you know what, you know, you kind of made the decision that that's what you want to do, but you had no kind of background or experience handling dogs before.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, other than the, you know, the basic, you know, teaching my house dog the basic stuff, sit down and stay. And I'm not a huge believer in, you know, epiphanies and I guess destiny, but man, that's the only way I know how to describe it. It was like right then it just hit me, and it was kind of like, this is what you need to do. And I've been a lifelong, science lover. But at that point, I mean, I didn't know how much, I would eventually build a love for behavioral psychology and, of science from that. But yeah, man, it absolutely hit me at once. And it was something that I knew that I guess I needed to do would be the only way to really describe it. And, it turned out to be a great choice. I'm glad I did.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'd say it's pretty important if, it basically changed the entire course of your life. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't think I kind of grasped exactly how big it was at that moment, but I can still vividly, very vividly, like it happened a few minutes ago. Remember the picture even and exactly how I felt. I knew that was what I wanted to do. I knew that's what I needed to do. It changed everything. But I was lucky enough to get selected to go to the handler's course. From there, I found out about another course that was still relatively fresh. It hasn't actually been in the military that long, but it's called the Specialized Search Dog course, or trainer's course is what it is. And I got selected for that, and I got to learn how to train dogs to work. I mean, completely independently, off leash, out of sight, 300-400 meters away, using a radio harness. We train them to listen to commands over a radio harness on their back. We have a headset on. We tell them things like forward. You send them out 200 or 300 yards. So you can, you know, safely search a building in Iraq or Afghanistan before you send guys in, or any area, open area, vehicles, things like that. You can send the dog up to search by himself before anybody actually has to go up there, recall him back safely.
What are those dogs like when they're not working? Like, are they playful dogs with that kind of personality, or is it pretty much all business once they get into that line of work?
No, absolutely not. The bond that you have with those dogs is incomparable to the bond that I've had with any dog I've ever owned. I mean, I mean, not only are you relying on this dog when you're deployed, you're relying on it on a daily basis to not just save your life, but you are there with, you know, 10, 30, 40. If it's a convoy, man, you're protecting hundreds of people. So not only, you know, do you trust that dog, but you have to trust that dog to a point where you can entrust it with other people's lives, which is a whole other scenario. So, and not just that, but that dog looks at you. I mean, you are not just handler. I mean, it's really hard to put to words, but, no, they are like your house pooch, man.
Gosh,
when it's not working. Yeah, it is. It's like any other dog. But as soon as that harness goes on or as soon as that cue starts to search, yeah, they're on fire. They're ready to go. They're ready to go work.
So that's the trigger is what when they get the harness on, they know it's time to go to work.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of dog training, a massive percentage of it is working with cues. I mean, that's, you know, and associations. So, we wouldn't give the dog free toys, free food. You know, they have to work for everything that they get, which builds this massive drive. Well, they know the only time they get to go work is when that harness comes on. So whether it be explosive detection or narcotics detection or bite work, they know that the only time they're going to get that bite sleeve or suit or toy is when they put that harness on. And it's hilarious, man. It never gets old. When you put that harness on some dogs, they'll literally start to shake. They're so excited to go work. They're so excited to go get that toy or that bad guy in the suit.
Now, how do we replicate that in humans so that they're that excited to work?
Yeah, right? I know. Yeah, absolutely.
Million dollar question right there.
But, How do we do that?
Yeah, I got a question for you. In that program that you were teaching the dogs how to do this remotely, you know, from a couple hundred yards away or 100 meters away, what kind of hours were you putting in with the dog on a daily basis?
No less than 6 hours a day, 5-6 days a week for about 6 months.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a daily thing. It's every single day. Now, yeah, I mean, that's training multiple dogs, but it's a lot of work. It takes a lot of time, a lot of focus to, get them to do that. But I mean, once they're there, it's really a lot of maintenance. Dogs are so intelligent. They're so smart. It's a lot of work at first, but yeah, they can be trained to do, I mean, literally anything. It's crazy. A lot of the stuff that's even coming out now past that, but quite a bit of work.
What kind of breeds are you normally working with in that capacity?
Belgian Malinois. That's a dog. It's actually started to get some notoriety. There's a movie that just came out. I don't know if you guys are familiar with, called Max. I haven't heard of that one. Okay, yeah, that's a Belgian Malinois. It's funny because I say that to people and they're like, "What the heck are you talking about?" But it is a it's sort of Belgium's answer to the German Shepherd. Same thing, shepherd, sheepdog, and, we had a lot of those, a lot of Dutch shepherds, German shepherds, and depending on the program, there were some labs. When I worked with the State Department, we actually had a few pit bulls. So, depending on the drive of the dog, how willing are they to go after that guy in the suit, or how willing are they to go after that toy? Past that, you can really train them to do anything. Once they have that drive to hunt for, or that prey drive to chase, you can train a dog to do whatever you need it to do.
That's incredible, man. That's absolutely fascinating. So, so you were doing that for a while, and then kind of, you know, what happened after that?
Yeah. So from there, that was the final military school that I went to, and, I got sent to my unit, the, 2nd Marine Expeditionary Force in Camp Lejeune. And that was a, deployable unit, we call them. I never acted as a military police during wartime. It's not uncommon that they stand up these dog units where you literally just train the dog and deploy. So we would do that. We would train for 4 to 5 months, deploy for 6 to 8 months, and then come back and sort of do that over, over and over again. And yeah, that was awesome. I love that job. Waking up every single day to train, you know, 5 to 10 to, you know, sometimes having your hands on 20, 25 dogs, it was awesome. I mean, you can't beat that. But
is it all individual training? Is it one-on-one training when you do it with the dog, or are they trained in groups sometimes too?
Yeah, no, we would load up a it's cool. We had these like awesome dog trailers built where it's like eight kennels, you know, like four on each side on this you know, trailer, but they go pull behind a truck and we'd go find training areas and set up venues. So yeah, it wasn't uncommon depending on how far we had to travel to train, you know, 4, 8, 15 dogs every day. And that's where I got a lot of time in. That's where you learn a lot of things, is those hours that you put in, those multiple dogs that you have your hands on. Because I mean, they're like people, man. They all have their own quirks. They all have their own issues. Some of them are having good days. Some of them are having bad days. So you get to work with all different kinds of dogs.
I mean, the whole spectrum.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Cause I mean, there's labs are much different than German Shepherds, which are much different than Dutch Shepherds. They all take a different approach. I mean, they're never the same. Never the same.
Fascinating. I know we're going to obviously get to this later though, but it almost seems like a lot of the dog training out there is a one size fits all, like, you know, with no real regard to what the breed is. So I didn't necessarily realize how much of a difference in disposition there might be between the breeds.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there's definitely a one-sided methodology and even approach. I mean, the methodology you use, like whether, you know, it'd be something like classical conditioning or like operant conditioning, it's all behavioral psychology. Now, when you get down to the specifics, though, of how you actually use that, of how you actually train the dog, the different techniques, I mean, there's hundreds of different ways to train a dog to sit. There's hundreds of different ways to train a dog to go forward or left or right. And depending on the dog, they may need a different method. They may need a different style. And yeah, I mean, it's just going to help learning occur much faster and make, you know, my life as a dog trainer and the, you know, the owner's lives a lot easier, the faster I can get through different tasks. But yeah, that was a lot of fun. But then, from there I was in for, 5 years and 3 months. I extended because I needed to go to Afghanistan one more time. And then after that I got out, and took a job with the State Department at the, U.S. Embassy in Kabul, Afghanistan. I was a training kennel master there, which meant I was responsible for all the training, of every dog that we had on contract. And that was, I mean, just what I had done in the military times 10. I mean, every day you're waking up super happy. I had, was it 53 dogs I got to go get hands-on every day. I mean, they had handlers, but you get to set up venues and do training with the handlers and tackle certain issues that they're having. You have new dogs come in, you know, that need to be completely retrained. That was awesome. But, and definitely, you know, what I consider an important job. I mean, those dogs were being used to protect, I mean, the highest of VIPs. You know, John Kerry had come through, Hillary Clinton had come through various times, you know, a lot of generals, things like that. You're responsible for, the security of the U.S. Embassy in Kabul, Afghanistan. So, that was a beast in and of itself. And where I definitely got to learn a lot, setting up venues for all these different dogs and, you know, catering to them and trying to advance them as far as we could. Very, very fun job. Very, very, you know, it was a great time. But, I had come to the conclusion that I didn't want to be there. I didn't want to do that forever. It was fun, but, and the same reason I had got out of the military, I've never wanted to be defined by one thing. I hate, you know, I always want to move on. I want to advance, and kind of perfect my craft. And if you stay stagnant for too long, if you stay in one place for too long, you're only going to advance as far as that's going to allow you. So,
I think that's like the 80-20 kind of, like, you know, the law of diminishing returns, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And so I had realized that there was a side of this that, or a side of dog training that, you know, maybe for many the most common, but one that I hadn't hit, and that was helping people on a daily basis with their dogs. I mean, I was working on the highest level of dog training, but I have developed like a lot of my own theories over time and a lot of things that I wanted to test and proof and advance. And I guess I just saw the state of what is the norm in dog training, I guess, like for actual personal dog trainers that you would hire, and was absolutely disgusted. And I guess I kind of once again had a calling and felt like I needed to go tackle that. And that's where I am now in Myrtle Beach.
So for not believing in destiny, you've had a couple dates with destiny so far.
Yes. 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 Absolutely. I know. It's funny when you say it aloud and, right. you're really like, oh man.
That's incredible.
No, yeah. Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct.
it's interesting to see, you know, how many people have a dog, right? The vast majority of people or families have a dog or have had a dog or are going to get another dog. And what's crazy a little bit, maybe a lot of it, and why Tim came to this sector, is how little we actually know about, you know, the psychology of a dog or, you know, how to train the dog for that matter. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I guess, yeah, that's, you know, not a way that we think of it all the time. We get the dog because you're supposed to get a dog, right? You've got a kid now, so you got to have a dog. And you don't, there's no research done on, you know, this animal that you're bringing in the house, how to best, care for it, how to, you know, And we just go by what we see on the TV, what we see, you know, or what we read in books. And I guess a lot of that is false. So, I guess I'm here to kind of change that, to help people through and really make people successful, when trying to train their dogs and just make the family unit happier. You know, I mean, I work with so many people that are just absolutely frustrated, fed up. And it absolutely doesn't have to be that way. It does not have to be that way.
Definitely. So I want to ask you, you know, you came to Myrtle Beach. How did you kind of hook up with, you know, K9Cabana? How did you decide that that's, you know, where you're going to call home?
Yeah, it took a little bit. I mean, I had toured, well, I'd been contacted and toured other facilities, and it was kind of disheartening, because it wasn't exactly what I thought it was going to be. I wasn't really happy with a lot of the facilities that I had trained. Most of them, I mean, yeah, boarding facilities and various other training facilities in the area. And, I was contacted by, Lorraine, the owner of, K9Cabana, and, I went for a tour, man. And right then I was like, these people really care. These people want to help, you know, they absolutely care about the dogs that they have. I mean, they treat them like they call them their dogs. I mean, like it's their dogs, you know, the owners just sort of have them for a while, but then they eventually bring them back home. And, so I love that attitude. And, I knew that's where I wanted to work. Absolutely. The attitude there is awesome. They're great.
Well, I imagine you had the bar was set pretty high considering your background of where you had come from. So just anywhere wasn't going to cut it.
No, absolutely not. I just didn't want to throw in with anybody. I wanted to find a place where I could be successful with the business. And it's been a great relationship. So, I love being a part of that company. I definitely back them 100%. And that's the thing is I didn't want to work for someone where, yeah, sure, I could immediately get a lot of clients. You know, but that's not what I wanted. That's not the whole reason why I got into this specific part of the field. I want to do it to help people out. I want to do it to make people's lives easier. If I, you know, wanted to make a lot of money, I would have stood contracting. You know, that's an easy six figures every year off the bat. So, that's not hard. Yeah. I wanted to advance my craft and help people out, and that's what they do. So It was a no-brainer, man. It was no-brainer. It took like 10 minutes on a tour of there. Until I decided, like, okay, yeah, this is it. This is where I want to be.
And how long have you been there now?
I've been there 7 months. Yeah, 7 months I've been there. Right. Yeah.
That's incredible. And so, you know, for everyone who doesn't know, you know, as much about K9Cabana, obviously, you know, it was the bar, like Doug was saying, the bar was set pretty darn high and it passed your test there. But it's more than just dog training, right? Tell us a little bit more about what you guys have to offer.
Oh yeah, K9Cabana is like full service facility. They have, boarding, daycare, grooming. They have a 24-hour staff, which means somebody's always there to check on the dog. I mean, this place is insane. I was laughing when I was looking at the website. They have like room service for the dogs. Like you can get your dog. I swear I'm not lying. Like you check out the website. Like they have like peanut butter doggy ice cream and like massages. Oh,
that's my favorite.
Yeah. Right. Absolutely. And, you can have your dog stay with the overnight staff, like literally sleep on the bed with the overnight staff. They're awesome. The dogs weren't, and this is one of the things I did when I walked through, I noticed they had times written on the, they're not kennels, by the way. They're cabanas. That's what they're called there.
Interesting. And,
yeah. Right. And so the dogs were never in for longer than like an hour. They'd get taken out in the morning, get put into like a large play group with similar dogs. And then they're outside in fenced in areas they have for like 3 or 4 hours. Get put down for a nap, cause they have nap time. I thought that was pretty interesting. And then get taken back out for another 3-4 hours, dinner time. And then they go to bed. I mean, the place it's awesome. It's insane.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
I feel like there's so much, you know, there's so much uncertainty, you know, you've got such a bond with your dog and then to just leave it with somebody you don't know can be a really, scary thing to do. And I know that my wife and I, you know, typically won't do that. Now I'm in Charleston, so I wish that, I was able to take our dog to a cabana like this.
Yeah. But, yeah, right.
But I think it's just like that uncertainty and not really knowing, like, do these people have like an ownership mentality with your dog? Do they care for your dog like they would their own? And it sounds like that's exactly what's happening here, which is awesome.
Yeah. And it's funny that you say that. The owner has told me this story so many times, Lorraine, that she remembered being a child. And the whole reason she started it was she remembers, being a kid and, she's from New York. And they would go on vacation and they'd put the dog in one of those like real shady concrete bars, like just bad looking place. Cause that's all that they had. I mean, that was the standard, you know? And, so she remembers being young, sitting in the back of the car and asking her dad, like, what's it like in there? You know, like, you know, buddy, like he's not going to have that much fun. And then she remembers her father telling her like, oh, he's going to be sitting on the beach, like drinking drinks and hanging out with his friends and he's having a great time. And so I guess that kind of stuck with her over time and just sort of that thought of like, why can't it be nice? Like people care so much about their dogs. Why can't this be as good or better than what they have? So that's what it is. It is kind of, it is a dog resort. A place. You don't even need to be on vacation. You take your dog there to socialize, you know, get pampered, get treated right, get training, get everything he needs. It's a great spot. I can't talk it up enough. It's great.
That's incredible. Yeah. I didn't realize that they don't actually have a kennel, that it's just, you know, like legitimate, cabanas. I think that's awesome.
Yes.
And,
yeah.
You know, something I saw too, when I was, you know, going over a little bit of background on K9Cabana, is what we briefly hit on there is with, you know, the 24-hour staffing. You know, I never really thought about it because I've boarded my dog in the past several times and that was never a question I had. It should have been. It probably should be the first question most people ask, but it's probably a question most people don't know to ask. So, you know, the fact that you guys have that, and from what I understand, not many other facilities do.
Yeah, no other facility in the area has it. We're the only one. I mean, and that's kind of like a lot of them have cameras, but I don't really see much good that would do, because a lot of the dogs that we take, I'm trying to think, I think currently right now we have 12 dogs on medication, some of them kind of serious. So that's why we have the overnight staff, is to check on them periodically, see how they're doing, making sure everything's fine, making sure, you know, they have water and everything that they need. You're right. It seems like something that should be a no-brainer. And I think we falsely assume that, you know, places will have certain services as standard, but the reality is they just don't. And this is the only one in, don't quote me. I think it's anywhere near the, you know, any area close, beyond Georgetown that has a 24-hour staff there all the time that actually sleep there, stay there with the dogs. But yeah, you're right. It should be something that's standard. And I think we assume that it is, but it's not, it's absolutely not.
Yeah. You know, and especially for people who own dogs, which is a lot of people that really, really love their animal, it's a no-brainer. You know, if I had to choose, between two facilities and, you know, one had 24 staffing and the other one didn't, it's a no-brainer. I would board my dog with the 24-hour staff regardless of the price. I wouldn't even look at the price. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. It's a family member, man. Absolutely.
Incredible. Definitely. Incredible. Cool, man. Well, you know, I've got a question I want to ask you here about some common, questions that you get, or maybe the most common misconceptions people have about, you know, what it is you do.
There is a lot. There's a ton that get thrown at me. It's, oh man, I got a laundry list. Yeah.
Just give us a couple off the top of your head that are just, you know, you hear from people more often than not.
Small and hyper dogs and how easy they are to train. Those are probably the two most, or we could even throw old in there as well. That they're harder to train, and they're just not, especially in the case of like the misused word of hyper. I like to change it to high drive. That hyper dog wants something kind of like back when we were talking about the working dogs, and the only time they got toys was when they were working, and when they knew they were going to get the toy, they got really excited. Those would be described as hyper dogs, crazy, you know, running over the couch, jumping off the back, you know, knocking the kid over and acting just absolutely insane. They're high drive. Once we direct that drive to something, once we, create a method in which the dog gets a reward or payment, as I like to call it, then, you see a lot of those issues go away. Once the dog's working for something. Small dogs, that's an issue that's created by all of us, with me being guilty as well, because you see that small, cute little dog and you treat it like a small, cute little dog. Therefore, you're creating issues because it's constantly being picked up. It barks, you pick it up. It barks, you pet it. You know, it does all those stereotypical small dog things, and we treat them in stereotypical small dog ways, which just compounds and creates issues. But as soon as that is taken away, and as soon as we have started a method of training, started teaching that dog yes and no, which is where it all starts, then all those issues go away. I mean, once we make it clear to the dog what we want them to do and that we're willing to give them something for it, it's limitless what you can train a dog to do, especially hyper and small dogs. They are ridiculously intelligent.
Well, I feel like you're spying on me, Tim, with my small dog, because
what do you got?
You just nailed me to a T. A Lhasa Apso. 13 pounds, a little diva, and I know it's my fault.
A little ball of cute fur. Yeah, absolutely. No, and that's the thing, is that and a lot of these small dogs are terrier based, which means that they have that prey drive, I call it. That's the chase the little thing and grab it. And
mm-hmm. Oh my God, yeah.
Oh my God, it is insane what you can do. I get a lot of Yorkies, really, really common dog in the area. Awesome dog. I mean, I absolutely understand why it's a common dog. But they are no harder to train than a large dog once we begin to treat them like a large dog. But because it's kind of hard to wrap your head around that. It really is. And I think that's something that takes clients a while to kind of realize. But it's small and cute and you want to pick it up and you want to treat it in a certain way, but until certain lessons have been instilled, until, you know, that yes, no has been instilled, then you're just creating issues every yeah. time. Every time you coddle that dog unnecessarily and treat it how we all love to treat small dogs. And I am so guilty too. It is so tough. We get so many small dogs at K9 Cabana and like, I swear they lose like so much muscle mass when I'm there in their legs because they never touch the ground. And yeah, I'm guilty too, but.
That's hilarious. That's why I just stay away from small dogs. They scare me.
But you love Amber, Sean. That's my dog's name, Amber.
I do love Barnaby. Yes, yeah. I do. But, general rule of thumb, you know, cause we're in real estate and, you know, for some reason, it just seems like the small dogs or the dogs that get treated like small dogs, are the scariest when a stranger is in the house. I've had my finger bitten and my ankle bitten several times from homeowners' dogs, even though they said, oh, don't worry, he's harmless. Sure enough.
Right, because they can kind of get away with saying that, and it's a small dog. It's only going to be a quick nick.
Yeah, no, nothing with teeth is harmless. No dog. Every dog has teeth. Every dog can bite. None of them are harmless. No, absolutely not. And I think you're right. I haven't been keeping account, but I feel pretty confident saying that I have been bitten by more small dogs than big dogs, and it's simply because of that. They are not treated the same way that we treat big dogs. They're not treated like dogs, I guess is a better way to put it.
So would you say that that biting, if you had to kind of generalize, is from being, it's not from being scared because they're small, it's from something else?
It depends on the exact situation, but no, a lot of the small dogs that I work with that bite are confident, meaning that they are biting me because of, or they're trying to bite me because of, food aggression or toy aggression or something like that. So each time that that dog started to show those tendencies as it was getting older, it got picked up. It got petted. So at best, the response to the aggression was neutral. At worst, the response to the aggression was positive.
Rewarding. Meaning,
yeah, it was rewarded. Absolutely. So of course the dog's going to be aggressive. Of course the dog's going to show that. It's being rewarded for doing so. So why wouldn't it? You know, one time of being properly punished, especially at a young age, you won't have those behaviors, which is why you don't have those behaviors with large dogs. It is rare. I would say in a month, I'd probably only have one. Maybe one. I'd have to broaden the scope. Maybe one food aggressive large dog. In that same time period, I'll probably have four small ones.
Wow.
Interesting. And I've got a question about small dogs too here while we're on the topic. You know, you said it's, you know, this is potentially a misconception. But is it more of a challenge to train a small dog simply because they're physically smaller and you can't see them in the house, what they're doing as often? Or you can't correct them as quick, or you can't get to them. Does that make sense?
I mean, if you're training it to do a long jump, then maybe. But like, other than that, no. And I mean, no, they're not. They're the same. You know, in proportion physiologically, they're the same. You know, it's got the exact same brain. They're the same. It's just how we treat them really is what forms their behavior. And that's the basis of behaviorism. It's how we respond to different things, how we have responded to different ways that they act. Have we rewarded it? Have we punished it? No, I would say not. And I would say many instances, it's much easier. Because one of the hard things with large dogs to relay to owners and clients is how to properly correct a dog. We don't want to do too much. We don't want to make a dog fearful, but we don't want to do too little, whereas the lesson doesn't stick. And with little dogs, that's usually it's much easier. It's posturing, just something to let that dog know that what it's doing is unwanted. And it's really not tough. Yeah, but that's why. I mean, I would say that is absolutely the largest misconception is gotcha. That small dog that I was guilty of myself too. You know, even when I was, you know, back in the military working for the State Department, that's a common theory that I held that, oh man, what am I going to do with these little dogs? But after I've started working with these small dogs and using the exact same techniques or the exact same basis of training, man, it's so much easier. They're quick. They're no more difficult. Absolutely not.
Okay, good.
So I I've the laundry list of questions is so long, but as far as correcting and stuff goes, and again, maybe it's dangerous to generalize or maybe it's not, but you know, I think there are some different theories floating around, and a lot of them are you know, not necessarily based in any fact, but that, you know, that physical correction is good or bad, or that you really want to be, you know, you want to be in a dominant stance over the dog and stuff like that. What are your, if you had to give just, you know, a little bit of insight on correction, or a little guidance on that, what do you think is the most important thing to keep in mind?
Yeah, here's where we make some people upset. No, I think I alluded to earlier, what I follow is behavioral psychology. That's all I use. Operant conditioning.
And define operant conditioning real quick, just for everybody.
Operant conditioning that, was started by John B. Watson and then later B.F. Skinner. And it is just, you've heard of positive reinforcement, I'm sure. Everybody's heard positive reinforcement. It's that positive method of training. I call it, you know, hot dogs and hugs. It's all happy. You get rewarded for doing the good thing. And that's positive reinforcement. But then there's this three other parts of it that many people are unfamiliar, like positive punishment and then negative reinforcement and negative punishment. And so I'll utilize all those portions to train a dog. Most trainers today, I feel very confident saying, will only use one or two sides of that. The most common being positive reinforcement. That's rewarding a wanted behavior. And then positive punishment. That's what you're talking about. That's correcting a negative behavior, an unwanted behavior, something that you don't want the dog to do. You're actually physically correcting the dog. And physical correction's a little misleading because sometimes all that's needed is a verbal correction, a loud sound. But that's why I had said earlier, the first thing that I teach any dog that I work with, this is the one kind of common denominator, is I need to know that the dog knows yes and the dog knows no. What that means is that I train no the same way that many other trainers teach sit. So the dog will associate no with something unpleasant, something bad. I mean, whether it be a can shaking or it be a loud noise or it be a correction on a choke chain, it depends on what the dog needs to get that response. It's basically a correction is whatever method you need to use to get the proper response. We don't want to go too hard because, like I said before, we're going to make that dog fearful. And that is not what we want. That's the last thing we want. I want a confident, strong dog, not a submissive dog, not a fearful dog. That's a very, very bad thing. Those are your fear biters. Those are the dogs that I really don't like working with. But
gotcha.
Yeah, but no. Corrections come in so many forms. And it's really just that amount of punishment needed to get the proper response. Now imagine I hook your legs up to electrodes, right? And I have some basic math in front of you. 3 + 3, 2 - 1, 10 + 7, nothing crazy. Well, there's a point in which when I turn that up, you can't think anymore. You can't do the most basic of math, and we never ever take it that far because what we're giving the correction for is to let the dog know that what it did is wrong. And then we immediately give it something right to do to let it know that's what it needs to be doing. And then we pay it for it. We give it that reward. So it is kind of tough to answer because it does depend on the dog and it depends on the situation. There is no generalized correction. I like to think of it as like a 1 to 100 scale. Of how much they need, because punishing a dog that, you know, peed in the house is very much different than a dog that is like currently chasing the mailman down, meaning to kill him. Like those are two very, very different things. So yeah, it does depend, but I am not against physical corrections. That's operant conditioning, man. That's what we know works. And it's the most clear way to talk to the dog, which to me seems like the only fair way to train it. That's like, not doing that is like speaking half English, half Mandarin. They only understand portions of what you're saying. Like, okay, I understand this is good, but they aren't necessarily understanding what's wrong. So yeah, we have to do that. We have to right. do that to be fair to the dog.
Yeah, it's like being physical is the universal way to communicate.
Yeah. Yeah, and like I said, that doesn't mean actually having to put hands on the dog or using corrective devices. Most times it doesn't need that. Only in our extreme kind of cases does it actually require that. But I'm not going to be opposed to that because I'm going to do what's best for the dog. I'm not going to refuse service to anyone. I mean, I'm going to do my best. I'm going to try. I'm going to do what I can to fix that dog.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah. Amber might need two hands.
Oh man.
Yeah. Right. No, absolutely not. Yeah.
Well, there's a little joke about Lhasa Apso's that they look in the mirror and they see a lion.
And so many do, but it's because of that confidence that we build in them. Now, a lot of those dogs are like that. A lot of the smaller dogs, and I'm a huge Yorkie fan. I absolutely love Yorkies because you're right. They're the same way. Like they are lions. There's a lion inside there and a really angry one most times an angry, hungry lion. But no, I love that. I love confidence in dogs. I don't try to do that. I don't try to build the calm submissiveness. I don't want a mope. I don't want a sad dog, a beaten dog, you know, who's been dominated or, you know, whatever the popular term is today. That's ridiculous. Confident dogs are happy dogs, man.
So you can teach confidence even on top of teaching behavior.
Yeah, a lot of that happens a lot in play. It's funny that we were just talking about lions because I ripped off this technique from lions. Actually, I was watching Discovery Channel as we do, and in Nat Geo, and I was it was a lion documentary, and David Attenborough, who does all of them, was explaining that the male lion will like roar really loud and act like he's hurt whenever the cubs bite him or pull on him. They'll over exaggerate it. I'm sure most of us have seen that in like a lion documentary. And I guess I never really thought of why, but it is to kind of instill in those cubs that they are tough. Like you can beat dad. Like you can under the right circumstances. There's still control over their cubs, you know, but, it's to instill that confidence. And, I'm telling you, a beaten down dog, a dog that has been dominated, like is so powerful now to build that calm, submissive dog is just a million times harder to train. I mean, it's just beaten. It's just, there's nothing there to work with. And, I love that confidence because they're snappy. They're ready to go. They want to work. And I've never been worried about being bitten by one of those dogs. It's never happened. Yeah, social confidence. That is absolutely the way to go. But I rip that off, with the lions and show a lot of my clients how to play with their dogs in the same way where, it does build that confidence in the dogs. And then you see they are so much more receptive to training. They are so much more ready to go. They're more excited to play. They're more, you know, excited to work. And, yeah, that's just one way to do it.
That's fascinating.
Incredible. Yeah. Absolutely. Holy cow. Well, awesome. Awesome. Well, want to move along here to a couple, quick kind of fun questions. I think we've kind of maybe touched on some of them, but nonetheless, here we go. Tim, are you ready, my friend?
Absolutely ready, sir.
All right. Here's a tough one. What kind of dog do you have?
I have Yeah, this is tough. I have a blonde lab. I have a, big old box lab, just a couch potato. Everybody like thinks I'm going to say something really crazy, like an XL pit bull or, you know, blue heeler or something. Nope. I've got the most chill, cool, you know, getting old yellow lab. Yeah. Really good dude.
That is awesome.
What's his name?
Spunk Ransom.
Spunk Ransom.
Yep, absolutely.
That's awesome. Well, all right, got another one. Well, Doug already spilled the beans on what kind of dog he had. I was going to have you guess what kind of dog I have.
What kind of dog you have, Sean?
Yep. And I'll give you a hint. You mentioned it already today, which was a lot of dogs.
No, I think you're a German Shepherd guy.
Pretty damn close. That's impressive. Yeah, I've got a like a Belgian mix.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, so hey. Pretty crazy.
Wow,
actually,
Tim, that was pretty good.
Yeah, that was fantastic. I was kind of anxious for Doug, but then he had to spoil that. But,
yeah, right.
Yeah, we rescued him about, 7 years ago. Didn't know what he was until one day at the dog park, like maybe a year later. Someone was like, oh man, you got a Malinois. I'm like, excuse me? And so that's when I kind of learned and started doing research on it. So
that's insane. That is so cool.
Riley was pretty submissive and beaten down, at least mentally, when you first got him. Isn't that right?
Yeah. It was kind of a sad story. I guess I would call myself a little bit above average, dog handler for normal people.
Yeah.
And so when I went to rescue him, he was actually kind of it was actually out in Conway, like maybe 6 or 7 years ago. But he was in the big kennel, as a little puppy. And he was just absolutely traumatized. It was the saddest thing. And, he was kind of on the verge of, not being a puppy. So they kind of, they had him in with the big kennels. And, I knew that that's who I wanted to help. I knew that most people were going to look at this dog and say, not a chance. Because he was flight mode to just scared out of his brain. So, So I took it on and, it was a lot of work, but, he's fantastic. He's seven years old. Dude. Yeah. He's doing great.
That is awesome.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No, those are awesome. Awesome dogs. I would love. Yeah. I mean, definitely some of the most trainable dogs. I mean, hence why, the military, every military in the world and police department, floods to them. They are so, so intelligent, sometimes for their own, too much for their own good, which I'm sure you know a lot of. But,
yeah. Oh, yeah. Awesome, man. Well, cool. Well, wanted to ask you, too, real quick, what's one of the most challenging things when training a dog in working with the human aspect of it or working with its owner?
I would say it'd be like most things that you're instructing people on or training people on. It's a lot of times the ones that have been doing it longer or, believe that they have a better idea of it are, they've developed a ton of bad habits. So it's kind of hard to get past a lot of those or certain like indoctrination they may have, things like that. It's going to be harder to work with people that believe that they may know more. And a lot of people have the right idea, have been on the right path, and it's not every single person, but that's definitely it. Those that are, you wouldn't believe, I mean, there's a lot of people that, do call in and, I'll go out and, they sort of kind of know everything already. And it's like, oh, I'm trying to help you.
It's like, why do you call?
It's pretty simple.
But, so the human's the challenge, the dog's the easy part.
No, yeah, the dog is ridiculously easy. It is usually, and that's the big battle with every dog trainer in the world is finding out ways to relay these lessons pretty easily. Cause it did take me years and years and years and years to develop a lot of this and to get a solid understanding of this. So, I would say that overall, I mean, has to be the most challenging part is relaying those lessons that are going to fix those issues. And I think that's what, separates a good dog trainer from like a great dog trainer, regardless of experience and all that is how well they can relay to the owner what they need to be doing to fix their dog. But, just like anything else, it's typically harder to train an owner that has been doing it longer and knows quite a bit because you're having to retrain on top of what they already know. I love getting brand new owners because they are, they know nothing and they are so much faster, typically faster and, easier to train. They're very responsive to what you say, but,
Makes sense.
I think that's interesting that with what you do, it's just one piece of the equation is knowing how to train the dog. There's a whole nother side of things that you need to master. And that is communicating with the person and probably your behavioral psychology, background. Comes into play there too.
I know. I'd like to think it does. Definitely have used some behavioral psychology on owners, because behavioral psychology is not something easy to digest. It is not one of those things that you train somebody to do or you're like, yeah, just Google it when I'm not here.
because you get all these crazy words like titration and anthropomorphism and, you know, F1 stimulus and F2, and it's very, very confusing. And unless you have studied it for years and years, then you're not going to have a solid grasp of it. But it is easy to digest, and there is easy ways to explain it. But yeah, it's definitely not something I have people look up on their own, because it's just a headache kind of waiting to happen. And I understand that. I mean, it's not the most fun read you can have.
If you're having insomnia, go ahead.
Yeah, I've got some textbooks you can borrow.
Oh man, that's awesome. That's awesome. Well guys, we're getting toward the end of our time here, so we've got a couple more things I want to hit on, and Tim, you've given some incredible advice, and so I'm going to ask you to give us a little bit more, because that's what we do here at the Myrtle Beach Advice Givers. And so, you know, for everyone who's listening who, you know, either has a dog, wants a dog, or knows someone who has a dog, you know, I want them to pay attention here, because some of the advice that you've given is fantastic. What I'm going to ask you here is going to be very valuable as well. So, you know, if you wouldn't mind sharing with the listeners today, kind of in your opinion, what are the three biggest mistakes that dog owners make, and what should they do instead?
Yeah, absolutely. Probably the first I would have to say is before they get the dog, absolutely, is not conducting research on what dog they're gonna get, what they expect that dog to do, what they expect it not to do, sometimes more importantly, and just getting a lot of research down. We have the best intentions when we get a dog, and like you were saying with your Malinois, and I think I even heard you say that you kind of looked them up and, you know, saw what they were. And it's one thing when you do the research and you know kind of what you're getting yourself into, because I'm sure when you Google Belgian Malinois, the first like 20 things that come up is a Malinois doing bite work, is a Malinois right. doing protection work, you know, chasing down the thing and biting it. And you know, but on the other side of that coin, somebody may have the only idea they have of a Belgian Malinois is that, you know, cute Disney-like movie Max, where the Malinois saves the family and everything's all happy. And you know, we make like 15-year commitments with animals on 15 minutes worth of thought, and that's insane. That's crazy. Yeah, there's a lot of positives to every breed, but we also need to be able to accept the negatives. And doing that, you know, shouldn't dishearten anyone. It's a method to find the dog that'll really work best for you. And yes, there is absolutely exceptions. There's absolutely exceptions to every breed and every dog, but, you have to be prepared for them. I would say that's a big one that everybody's guilty of, that I was almost guilty of myself. I nearly bought a blue heeler, not that long ago. I love them, man. I remember watching Thunderdome, Mad Max Thunderdome when I was a kid. Like, it has just stuck with me. It is like my favorite dog, but, yeah, just, it's a lot of work though. I mean, the dog would have to get 3 to 5 miles every day.
Yep.
Right? Thank you. Exactly.
Well, you know,
exactly.
What you say is such a fantastic point, but it's something that, you know, no one does really, right? You know, no one does the research. It's like deciding to have a baby, getting pregnant, and then 9 months go by and you've read 15 minutes of a baby book.
Yeah, right? That's insane. Nobody would do that. That's craziness. And that's what I think happened with Dalmatians. I love to ask people, I'm such a dog nerd, I love to ask people what they think of Dalmatians. Like, what do you think of a Dalmatian? And everybody typically says, oh, they're aggressive. And we don't see people with Dalmatians anymore. Well, if we match the timeline up perfectly, it's when the movie 101 Dalmatians came out and every kid in the world wanted a Dalmatian, and nobody realized that they were high drive, prey driven right. dogs, and it was really bad in a lot of cases. And they're not mean dogs by any means. And nobody that gets one would be, you know, willing to say that. Anybody that knows what they got themselves into. You know, because you get a plan for the dog. When you know what to expect, you've got a plan in place. You know how, you know, at least have a vague idea of what you're going to do. Maybe get a trainer set up. Look at, you know, things that they need, like the 3 to 5 miles with a heeler. I would love to have that amount of time, but the reality is I don't right now. And it would be irresponsible for me to get that dog and not be able to give it that. I mean, my dog is totally fine laying on the couch watching Nat Geo when I'm not here. And so, you know, my lab's cool with that. He'll do that. So he's a great dog to have at this point with the amount of time I have to invest in my own dog. So yeah, that's definitely the first one is, you know, a lack of research. The second one, and, this one's tough. This one's tough for everybody. I mean, I want to say it took me a couple years of like solid, you know, being a dog trainer to kind of get this out. And, I touched on it before. It's called anthropomorphism. And it's a really long word that just means putting human traits and human values on a dog or on anything really. But in this instance, on a dog, on your dog. And we really buy a lot. I mean, like psychologically can't help that. We do that with everything. We get the toaster because it looks like a happy face. You know, we get it's marketing is all that. It's anthropomorphism. It's putting the human values. I mean, you look at a lot of the cars now, it's like literally they're trying to put a human face on it, and it appeals to us. Yeah. And we can't help that. But, when we do that, we wrongfully neglect the dogs of what they actually need as dogs. We're not, you know, constantly thinking about their needs that they've evolved to need. You know, social interactions, we coddle them too much. We don't give them what they psychologically need because, you know, Fluffy's tired, so I need to pick him up it is so through every owner that has a dog, everybody does it, and I'm guilty of it as well. But when we look at them as little people, as fur babies, we're constantly neglecting them, what they need as dogs, the training they need as dogs, the sometimes discipline they need as dogs. And it's no good. And that is alone causes so many issues, so many negative behaviors, treating them like people. Like, I mean, that's literally explains what we went over with the little dogs.
Right.
It explains it all pretty well is anthropomorphism. They're cute little babies and we want to pick them up.
it goes so far as, you know, we've got an alter ego for my dog, like a legitimate like personality, like, oh, I bet Amber says this or Amber's thinking that. I swear to God. I mean, it sounds crazy, but it's true.
Yeah, no, I do. Yeah. And I do the same thing. I catch myself doing the same thing with my dog, but, the more that we look at them as people is the less that we look at them like dogs. And that's not responsible to them. And that's, you know, we're not setting ourselves up to give them what they need biologically, psychologically, what they need as dogs when we do that. And this is something that they actually hit really hard in like every handler's course I've ever been to. It's so funny. It's like the one remaining factor because it is hard. It is something that we all do, we can't get rid of psychologically. We can't help ourselves from doing it. It's so funny. Like I've been to like train the trainer courses where like you already are a trainer and then you're getting, you know, trained in more advanced techniques. And, they still push this point. It's so funny because we just all can't help it. But,
incredible.
Yeah. And then last but definitely not least, one that is, very near and dear to me is that probably the biggest misconception that people make is thinking that their dog is a watered down version of a wolf and treating it as such. This is something that has gotten extremely popular lately on TV, in books, and there is zero, and I always say fact check me. I love to be fact checked. Like, you know, don't necessarily believe every single thing I say. I mean, we have to go out and research. That's, everybody should be fact checked, but, it's not. Your dog is not a watered down version of a wolf.
And explain a little bit, more exactly what you mean by that, just so everyone understands.
Well, we, typically like the Caesar Milan's, that method of training explains dog behavior by further explaining wolf behavior. Wolves have the same, just about the same, I don't want to nerd out here too hard, but just about the same biological, or just the same genetic similarity as we have to chimps. But nobody is going to the Congo to find out how they should raise their child. you know, by observing chimps. And further, like newer research has shown that they likely didn't even have a common ancestor, which means that dogs aren't even descended from wolves. No wolf from any zoologist, wildlife biologist has ever observed being a pack animal or a hunter, you know? And then when we take these romanticized idea, because that is really, I understand the appeal. That is really cool to think that your Yorkie is like this watered down, like version of like a noble gray wolf. And, but it's like I tell, you know, all my clients, like he's not busting through the door in front of you to reorder some innate pack hierarchy that he has in his head. The dude just has to go pee. So he needs to get outside. He's not trying to dominate you right now, and you don't need to flip him on his back and show your teeth at him. It's just that, and I think that's probably, that really is the hardest part. I mean, this is something that with just about every client, every owner I work with, I'm having to kind of go over and explain. And it's crazy to me because there is no scientific basis to this. There is no professional who has ever, you know, a wildlife biologist, a zoologist, or a behavioral psychologist who has ever said like, yeah, they're pretty much the same. Just, you know, go nuts with the wolf training. It's just not a thing. You don't have to be the alpha. There is no pack hierarchy. It's behavioral psychology. It's really simple. It's setting up rewards and punishments. You reward the good behaviors, you punish the bad behaviors. The behaviors you reward are going to show up a lot more often, like sit, like the paw, you know, whatever you're rewarding that dog for, whatever you're punishing it for is going to show up a lot less, like biting, peeing in the house, things that go away over the time. You know, they're not doing these things to dominate or to restructure some pack hierarchy, which, like more research would show, like, the wolves have to learn. They're not even born knowing this. And then we assume that our dogs are born understanding these things that even the wolves have to be taught over years.
Like it's coded in their DNA or something.
Right.
Exactly. And that, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if that was a quote by a lot of the trainers coming out now. and that's done because it's muddy, right? So not only now are you hiring me because I'm a dog trainer. I'm coming to your house because I'm a dog trainer, but you're hiring me because I can decode wolf. And how can I possibly explain that to you? Well, I can't. So you're going to need to have me back so I can decode some wolf again. You see where I'm going with this?
Yeah. Like,
it's not black and white. Like I can go in and teach somebody the basics of behavioral psychology and they can fix their dog. Not only the issue that they have, but other issues that will arise. It's the same blanket principle. And all my clients are free to contact me, you know, at any time. They don't need to be paying me. They can be former clients from a year ago. Let me know if you're having an issue. And I can, you know, kind of give them a quick rundown of how to kind of, you know, adjust that and make it work with a certain issue. But they already have the tools there to fix it. It's not complicated. It's not muddy. You don't need to buy my book, you know? You don't need to have me over. You don't need to have me over 10 times. Most of my sessions are done after like two sessions. That's it.
Wow.
Two or three. And they're gone. They're good. They don't need any more. A lot of them will have me back because they want to advance the dog. They want to teach it something new. But as far as like behavioral issues, it never takes long.
Wow. This is
remarkable.
Yeah. This is a really big idea. I mean, I've definitely, never heard this perspective, and you're far and away, the chief dog expert I've ever, encountered. So, and I have believed this pack hierarchy thing, the BS about who's going in and out of the door first and this and that. And, it's just crazy that is really just not based in fact. And it's all just kind of a myth, maybe
storyline,
commercial, you know,
narrative
for commercial purposes.
Yeah. And I mean, no, I mean, it sells books. It's romanticized. That's the only way that somebody that doesn't have a degree in anything, nevertheless, zoology, wildlife biology, behavioral psychology. I mean, don't when we think about it realistically, you probably shouldn't trust those people. When the other people, you know, when the people on the other side of the spectrum are saying the exact opposite or saying this is lies, this is fake, but that's harder to research because it doesn't, you know, bear as well in the media. It doesn't sell as much. It's not romanticized, but I mean, some of the methods, it's funny when we look at it because a lot of the methods are using behavioral psychology, but only a few of them, and it's not embracing it wholeheartedly, which means it's not going to be fixed, you know, indefinitely. The issues aren't going to be fixed, you know, forever. You don't know how to back them up. You don't know how to keep fixing something new that comes up or teach a new skill. It's set up to fail. And, like I had said earlier, that is one of the big reasons I got into it. It just angers me because this is not something that's difficult. This is not something that should take more than a couple sessions to figure out. And, people are just getting ripped off, and that's just doesn't seem fair. That doesn't seem right to me at all. You know, it's a mechanism that's set up to fail, and nobody would buy a car that was set up to break in, you know, 100 miles, 200 miles. So, you know, why would you, you know, we should get the word, like not hire somebody who's going to set you up to fail. It's not right.
Absolutely. So the moral of the story is don't believe everything you see on TV.
Yeah, no, I mean, fact check everything. I fact checked absolutely everything. You know, I mean, could you imagine how dangerous the world would be if we believed every single post that we saw on Facebook? Like, it would be terrifying.
I know, right? Well, the scary thing is that's kind of what's going on in politics right now.
Absolutely. You're right. It's fascinating, this election cycle. We have got the TV on like 24/7, just like popcorn ready, just waiting for the circus. It is the best entertainment, this election cycle.
Yeah. We really have no idea what's going to come next.
No, absolutely not. I love it because it could go anywhere.
Hilarious, man. Well, listen, that pretty much is going to wrap us up, man. Incredible insight and advice and input from you, Tim. I want to thank you, you know, for coming on here today. And, you know, before I let you off the hook here though, I want to give people a chance, to be able to, you know, get in touch with you or visit the website. So where can people go to learn more about you or connect with you and K9Cabana?
Yeah, you can, go to our website first, K9Cabana.com, or find us, go ahead and search that on Facebook and you'll find us. And, I can be hit directly at, my name, TimothyCulver@me.com. And you can contact me directly and, yeah, be happy to work with anybody. I love it. Yeah, absolutely. We love it.
Awesome. Awesome. And yeah, and, you know, I just wanted to, touch base too, you know, for anyone who's, needing some of the, you know, services or want to take their dog to get groomed or just a day spa. You know, K9 Cabana does have some, certain discounts. I know they work with firefighters, police, EMT, and military, which I think is fantastic because Doug and I also have a first responder only charity, you know, that we organize and work with. So, you know, if you fit one of those, people, definitely, you know, hit up K9 Cabana. They'll sort you out with a little bit of a discount there and appreciation of your, you know, your service, which I think is awesome. And, you know, two, I think Tim was mentioning here too. If you do mention this podcast, and you go into K9 Cabana, they might hook you up with a little, discount as well. Tim, is that correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. They mentioned Sean or Doug or the podcast and, yeah, we'll have special, training pricing for them. Absolutely.
Beautiful, beautiful. Doug, you got anything else for Tim before we let him go?
Oh man, I think we've run the gamut here. This has been awesome. I wish we had like another 2 hours with you because I've got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, this might be part one of a series at some point in the future. But yeah, Tim, man, we really appreciate you. Everyone, again, go get in touch with Tim. We'll put Tim and K9 Cabana's contact information somewhere in the show notes so you guys can make sure to reach out to them with any questions or connect or get some services. So, Tim, thanks again, my brother. Take care.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys.
All right, Tim.
Dude, what an incredible show. It was everything I thought it was going to be and more. Doug, how are you feeling?
Blown away. I mean, he turned everything I thought I knew about dogs, which admittedly wasn't all that much, but turned it upside down on its head. And I'm sure that everybody listening is going to feel the same way just because that the pack mentality that he was talking about, I feel like that's an idea that is so popular in the media. And now he kind of explained to us why. But, you know, to find out that that's all kind of BS and all smoke and mirrors is a little maddening, but also really happy that he's shown the light.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it boils down to just education, you know, being educated. And for, you know, it's still, I still find it fascinating for as many people like us that have dogs and have had dogs in the past and will probably continue to forever have dogs, you know, don't necessarily or aren't necessarily educated in dog psychology or how to train and give them actually what they need nearly as much as we should be. You know, I mean, goodness, I consider myself, you know, knowing more than the average bear, if you will. But after today's interview, again, I'm reminded that actually at the end of the day, I really still don't know much.
You know? Right. Well, and what's interesting is how he said that the owners who think they know a lot are sometimes the most difficult. It's the most difficult to help their dog. Not saying that necessarily towards you, because I know you've done a great job with Riley, but, I thought that was also of note as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it makes sense. It's, you know, I think people kind of get stubborn and stuck in their own ways, and they've had a habit of doing things for so long, and, you know, it's their baby, that I can see how it's definitely a challenge to have someone else come in and kind of tell them what they should or shouldn't be doing with their baby. You know, so a lot of incredible points hit on today. He gave a lot of great advice, which I'm really stoked about, and I know a lot of people are going to get some value out, and I hope anybody who's literally got any question about their dog or the behavior of the dog or something they're trying to do, reach out to Tim, man. He's awesome, you know. He'd love to talk to you. He'll probably give you a couple pointers, you know, free of charge, just because you saw how passionate he was throughout the whole interview, you know.
Such a cool dude.
So, again, guys, want to make sure you hop on over to K9Cabana.com. That is the letter K, the number 9, Cabana.com. And you can get in touch, you know, with Tim or, you know, K9Cabana if you want to look at some of their other awesome services. I'm excited to go tour the facility. I'll tell you that. I'm going to be reaching out to Tim here probably in the next week or so and line something up, because it's right there on Highway 544, you know, heading down towards Surfside from Myrtle Beach and from Conway. So right around the corner, great location, and sounds like they got some great people working over there.
For sure, man. It just seems like a great operation, and it's coming from the heart. This is, you know, to me, it seems like this is a passion project for the owner and for everyone who works there, and that's what you want with your animal. You do not want to drop your dog, you know, really your family member, off with someone who's just trying to make a buck.
Right. It's like getting your babysitter off Craigslist.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
Just some things you don't do. But yeah, I thought it was funny. I was actually going to bring up my claim to fame in my dog handling experience. But I felt so, I don't know what the word is. I didn't bring it up because I realized it's not a very big accomplishment or a good one for that. But, my claim to fame is in college, I trained my dog how to open the fridge, grab a beer, and bring it to me wherever I was on the property. Wow. At the time, it was like the coolest thing on the planet. And I thought, I was like, man, I'm a dog handling genius.
I'd still say that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's not too bad, but, you know, pales in comparison, obviously, to some of Tim's accomplishments. My goodness gracious, man. So anyways, guys, that is going to do it. We are going to wrap it up for the show. Unbelievable show. I want to thank Tim Culver again for making it on here. And I could probably definitely see us having him back on in a future episode to give us some more advice, because Lord knows we need it. So
thanks. The tip of the iceberg.
Yeah, the very tip. So, all right, that's it, guys. I want to thank you again for tuning in to this week's episode. If you like what you heard, head on over to iTunes and click that little subscribe button, or share it with a friend who you think could benefit from the show. If you've got any questions, comments, or concerns, or interested in being on the show, as usual, you can get all the deets at MyrtleBeachAdviceGivers.com, or you can send me an email to Sean, which is SEAN at MyrtleBeachAdviceGivers.com. Thank you so much, and we will see you on the next episode of the Myrtle Beach Advice Givers Podcast. Take care, everyone.